open the floor to questions, and I think we owe Professor Marcus the ability to respond to his respondents first, if you wish, or if you want to formulate your response. Okay, so we'll take questions. Yes, Professor Russell.
Okay, I'm an invader here, and I ask this question with trepidation. It's collegeshea.com. Ivan only mentioned the oral component of Sefer Chasidim when talking about circle versus movement. But what I don't understand is why there can't be an oral component all the way through. Why is it restricted to when Yehuda was teaching the stories, and then once it was written down, no more orality? I mean, there's a big literature about how, especially this kind of literature, the oral version and the manuscript version coexist and influence each other, and that even continues after print. We have example of Sheikh Tehavesh in the 19th century, where it's been proven that the oral version of the stories still influenced the written version, and vice versa. So why couldn't this be the case here as well, that there was an oral body of literature that existed all this time, and that the various recensions that you're talking about drew on that, and not just notebooks that you posit existed? That's one. Two, in passing, you talked about the Christian cultural elements in the book, and you separated between cultural ideas, let's call them, and forms. And recently, Ruth von Bernuth, in her study of the origins of the Chum stories, has posited that Jews are partners in Christian culture, but there are still social barriers, and that the inconsistency that you detect might be connected to that distinction. Of course, the question is, how does culture get communicated if there are social barriers? And number three, it's really none of my business, but you mentioned in passing Yehuda's move to Regensburg. I think that Ephraim Shoham might have something new to say about that.
Ongoing discussion. I think we'll collect two more questions from the panelists this month.
I think it's good that we should concentrate more on what happened between 1210 and 1300, those 80, 70 years before, or in the process that Sefer Chasidim became a book in the Parla edition. Now, you know that the libraries and Chasidim and they, I didn't hear one word. And the word is oral. Moshe took my job. Okay? But you see, because I mean, you wrote so many examples that you let Chasidim told the story or used lectures to his students. Everything was oral. And I think that without taking into account that during those 80 or 70 years, his students produced what they heard from him. And that process of oral becoming written, we are missing here a lot of understanding of what really happened.
And here.
Everything that is described here is actually, from a comparative point of view, happens in French medieval literature. In the I don't know, mythology of the about French medieval literature, she and her colleague had a big introduction talking about the conception of the author, the conception of the text, and the conception of the author text, what I refer to, it's very similar to what we're talking here, that the text is not a rigid text, and the author is not, there are many authors, those who wrote, those who compiled, those who edited, those who copied, and so on, and it's very similar. This is very typical to medieval literature in general.
Oh.
the two respondents first. You know, if we had more data, we wouldn't have to have 50 years of scholarship to figure out what Sacro-Cassiodea is. We're groping and we're trying to reconstruct from what is a fragmentary record. I want to thank Saskia for the way she presented. Where is Saskia?
Yes.
The way she presented the pyramids are now in, so they're either going to be right up or upside down, and the contents will then be up for grabs. I didn't pay attention to linearity among the versions, so this is a step forward. And the only question I have is when you start off by comparing Parma and Bologna, the way Push does, by dividing the manuscripts to the degree that they resemble either Parma or Bologna in the descriptions of all the manuscripts, then you are either using that division as a heuristic device, because everyone knows these two editions, and so one wants to know, is this one more like A, or is it more like B, or is it like both of them? But, I mean, the Schaefer approach, which I'm hoping to emulate here, is that you don't assume Parma, Bologna are in some way primary and prior to all the manuscripts, that they basically just happen to get published early. And the other ones, although shorter and have less material, aren't because of that weaker or less. And I don't know exactly why everyone seems to need the Parma-Bologna dichotomy to start with when they compare Sacro-Cassiodea manuscripts to each other. I was trying to neutralize the environment by saying the book was created in small passages. That's the original compositional act. The reason I say it is because individual parallels, even if they're not totally intact, they break apart and they come together again, like Lego. When you go from one manuscript to another manuscript, you don't get every word that's in the parallel in manuscript A and manuscript B. They break apart. And copyists aren't doing this. It means that the text itself is very fluid, and you don't get the same paragraphs in the same manuscript, and they're never in the same order, which to me means there is no textual tradition except between the pairs. So it's okay to say, well, Parma II developed, because we can see the tracks of how many are in each of the other versions that overlap with it, the Cambridge, and then the other Oxford manuscript. But I'm concerned about putting Parma, Bologna up there first, as I'm not sure what they're doing there, how it's being presented. I may be misunderstanding, either with Push and also with Saskia, as to why you start with Parma, Bologna. I'm trying to be equal to all of them and take the small paragraphs as the originary compositional database, but maybe I can understand better what I'm missing. So when you say mixed recensions, again, that bothers me because it means you're assuming Parma Bologna are somehow prior to the other manuscripts, either prior in time or prior in composition or somewhere it's prior. I'm not sure how. I need some more clarification on that. You're absolutely right that we don't have the worked up manuscript that became the first edition. This is an interesting issue, what happened in early printings. I became a little bit of an aficionado of print, early printings, and the history of print and the history of the book is a wonderful stuff. You can get caught up in it. It's extremely fascinating. Elisheva Karlbach has a new doctoral student coming up this spring, Joe Skloot, who did work on the early editions of Sacro-Cassiodea and the censorship of Bologna and Basel and so on. It's going to be a very interesting dissertation and book when it comes out. Early printings tore up manuscripts that became the first edition, not just in Hebrew. So it's not a surprise that we don't have anything resembling pre-Bologna. And remember, these books were not printed all at once because they didn't have enough letters. Often parts of a book were published 20 pages or 30 pages worth. The letters were reassembled into the next 20 pages, and so it's not even a uniform production of a single copy, let alone each copy of the same edition. Also, something that no one mentioned, but which is bothering me a lot, we don't have manuscripts of the Machbarot. That is, if we have all these recensions, three in Bologna and one in Parma I, You don't have any topical Machpera in the manuscript. And I'm wondering what that might mean. I'm sorry for going on so long. The other comment from David is extremely helpful. Yes, you're right, there are these correlations. If you assume a very small group, it sort of pushes back to Judah. You don't know. There's no real way of knowing how much he did. I don't think Eleazar had anything to do with Sefer Chasidim, because Eleazar had a tremendous obsession with himself and his name. And he labeled everything he touched with an acrostic name. He branded himself in all of his work. So I'm suggesting, and he disagreed with his teacher about this. His teacher wanted to be anonymous, and Eleazar wanted to be anonymous. So he wouldn't have left his name out if he was reworking his teacher's anonymously written material. So yes, it could have been Moshe's album, but the deduction the Occam's razor approach is really to give it to Judah until we have a smoking gun otherwise. It's the simplest, and you're right, it's reinforced by a small group of people. The influence, however, is not the same as the size of the group. We're making a mistake of thinking of movement as influence. Numbers at the beginning generate impact later. Why can't a small group of people have a tremendous influence? Revolutions are often started by very small groups of people, the intellectual class and all the rest. There's no evidence of a large group. There is evidence of influence. So you can have both. Yes. Now the question of oral is, if they all disappear as a social unit, then there's no one to talk to anybody else. In other words, the work itself is simply put on in from an oral stage into a written stage without social continuity. We're positing here that when he died in 1217, the son picked up his Chumash commentary and wrote it down from memory, often probably making mistakes, as Chaim Soloveitchik showed in the Turim 2 article, that he misunderstood even the pshat of what his father thought he could comprehend. He was wrong, he couldn't even get that right. So it's not likely that he was doing any of the highfalutin stuff, like Sefer HaKavod or any of these other things. It's not clear why we just simply don't have an oral phase when he's alive. His students disappear, he dies, and then it goes to writing. It doesn't, because you have a Hasidic movement, you have living human beings, so the oral tradition is capable of continuing for generations and interacting with the written traditions. And then, you know, Cyrus talked about the Agadot going from an oral proto-Yiddish stage to a Hebrew stage, and then written to the Yiddish stage later. So you start with oral, and then in the language of the vernacular, you put it in Hebrew so that it's high style, and then that gets transformed again later on, like the Maisa book, into Yiddish. So each one of these cases has to be looked at differently. But with Chassidei Ashkenaz, as soon as we start talking about a small circle, I think the oral aspect of it disappears. As far as the Christian barrier, of course, there are always these cultural negotiations, and that's what we're studying now. That's what Elisheva and Effie and all of us who are interested in the social and cultural reality of Ashkenaz, we're all trying to figure out how did these few Jews live among so many Christians and have attitudes towards them which are relatively negative and yet absorb so much of the culture all around them and Judaize it in some way so that they can live with it. So there's a process we're all trying to map. They didn't blend. And the question of Effie and Regensburg and who went where when, he and I are going to settle over a couple of beers.
We have 2 more minutes, so at breakneck speed.
Oh, I'm going to
make it come.
Okay.
Please. Yes,
David. I just want to comment on that text up there. You were talking about it being subverted by a sort of anti-Hasidi perspective, and you emphasized the use of the expression Alti Tzadik Harabe as being something which like, is the antithesis of Midah Hasid too. I'm not sure, because at the same time, I think the value that's being critiqued there is pride. The pride of the pietist at being a pietist. And that strikes me as something that is very Hasidic. that there's a certain tension built into pietism, which is in trying to exceed the norms, but at the same time not fall into the sin of being a norm exceeder.
So I agree with you 100%. I think that tension between being so pious that one is, you know, verging on insufferableness, right, or arrogance, is certainly something that we have to sort through. Just specifically with regard to this particular text, so I didn't get to this, but there it actually comes in a context with two other passages about Al-Tahid Karbe. So you're right, I was slightly exaggerating by saying that is not a pietistic notion. However, the way that it appears in these other two texts, and again, it's continuous, is the classic rabbinic idea of Al-Tahid Karbe when it comes to somebody else's physical expense. So for example, in Tafat Rishlamadet, if somebody is in a church and they're about to be killed, and you could go in and save them, but you don't want to because that would be going into a makom of Zara, that is Al-Tahid Karbe. I think that's pretty clear. The other one, though, where Al-Tahid Sadeh Karbeh would be not blowing your nose and wearing tefillin, well, we know that's what Hasi Ashkenaz didn't want you to do. So there I see the tension as being sharper, and my assumption is that whoever compiled this put that passage right next to these other two ones because the audience in the story is saying Al-Tahid Sadeh Karbeh, but they're not representing a pietistic view, they're actually representing, as I read it, an anti-pietistic view. But the broader question, the broader point I think is what you're going to.
Okay.